Well, I am just really thrilled to be here and to be here with this outstanding panel. Welcome to the CEO Bootcamp panel that is dedicated to your future. So, the two goals of this panel are, one, how can you be a more successful leader? And two, how can you grow your business? How many here would like to achieve both of those goals? Okay, great audience for this panel. So we're going to focus on starting small, growing bigger and bigger and bigger, and leading that organization. So before I introduce the panelists and ask them to tell you more about themselves, they're each going to tell you a little bit about who they are. I'd like to tell you just a little bit about the Women Presidents Organization. So the WPO I founded in 1997 because I saw that there were many programs for startup and young businesses out there, but nothing for women who had already achieved a certain level of success. Started with one chapter in New York City, 1997. Today we have 112 chapters on 6 continents. We are a peer learning group devoted to multi-million dollar women-led companies. Minimum revenue to join is $1 million. 2 million if it's a product. Average revenues of our members are 13 million. Average years in business are 23. Average number of employees are 95. Some of you may be saying, why does that impact me? Because I'm not there yet. Well, it impacts you because these women are great role models for you. And they are models that you can learn from. And most importantly, that you can emulate. 75% of our members have indicated since joining WPO that they have grown by between 5 and 50%. So we wish that for all of you. Okay, now to the panel. First of all, I am going to ask each of the panelists to tell you a little bit more about themselves. I want to start with the only guy. We already know he's the only guy, but we want you to know how gracious we are that you can go first.
Thank you, Marsha. It's an honor. I feel special. Thank you so much for having me. My name is John Gerzema, and I'm the author of the Athena Doctrine. My background is a researcher, and I spent the last 2 years doing research on this book, studying the evolution of leadership in society, and I also traveled the world about 2 years. I think I had hair when I started the project, but we'll get into it and talk a little bit about some of the people that we met.
Hello, thanks for having me. I'm Shelly Sun.
Well, wait, I was going to introduce you.
Okay.
And just say, Shelly is extremely successful. From the day that I first met her, I knew that that was the case. Shelly has that inner drive.
2005, and I'm a Women President Organization member, have been since 2004. So Shelly Sun, I'm the CEO and co-founder of BrightStar Care. So we do home care and healthcare staffing. If you think about it, we help grandmas and grandpas and moms and dads have to be able to stay at home, not have to go to a nursing home. So that's kind of the range of our services. We're in 265 markets in the U.S. and Canada, and about $260 million in revenues.
So Marianne Cooper, we want the inside scoop now on Lean In.
Well, I'm a sociologist. I got my PhD from Berkeley a few years back. I work at the Clayman Institute for Gender Research, and a couple years ago I got an email saying an opportunity, and it was a request that Sheryl Sandberg was looking for someone who's an expert in what I happen to be an expert in. And so that opportunity turned out to be the researcher for Lean In. So I spent the past couple years doing that, which has been a really great experience, and can talk about some of the issues today that we cover in the book. And in the spring, I'll have my own book coming out. It's called Cut Adrift, and it's about how families are dealing with economic insecurity.
Great. So Gail Warrior. Now, Gail is one of these women that we all love to hate because she's smart, accomplished, and beautiful, but we don't really hate you. We really like you, Gail.
Love you, Marsha. Good afternoon. I'm happy to be here. I am Gail Warrior, CEO of Warrior Construction, and I'm a general contractor, and we specialize primarily in federal contracting work, and probably in the past couple of years, because federal work has been on the decline, we've been doing a lot more of K through 12 in higher education as well. So we have a niche market in that's called permanent modular construction, and we've built over 4 million square feet of modular construction with the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers.
Okay, so we have a great panel, and I'm going to ask you some questions. And Marianne, we're going to start with you. So can you explain the correlation between likability and success for women and how that can potentially affect a woman's rise to leadership? Is there a correlation between likability and confidence? We were hearing about confidence just now from Angie. So
as it turns out, success and likability don't always go together that well for women. And the reason why is that it's really rooted in gender stereotypes. So our cultural beliefs about men are that they're assertive, decisive, driven. So when a man is professionally successful, or if he pushes his team to perform, he's really just conforming to our expectations about how he should behave, and we like him. On the other hand, women, our cultural beliefs about women hold that they're nice, friendly, warm, and nurturing. And so when a woman is professionally successful, if she pushes her team to perform, what's happening is that she's violating our expectations about how she's supposed to behave. She's insufficiently feminine and too masculine, and we don't like her. So this may be some, I'm sure it is something that women in this room have experienced, where if they deliver, you know, top level results in their job, what their coworkers will say, both men and women, is she's really good at her job. She's just difficult. She has sharp elbows, or she's not a team player, right? And this plays out all the time. And so the problem for women at trying to rise in leadership is, well, there's two issues. One is that I think girls and women sense this social backlash, and it lowers aspirations, because who doesn't want to be liked, right? So that's just a problem even getting women into leadership. Secondly, women pay distinct social penalties as a result of this in terms of promotion. And they can even be ousted in certain situations. So it's not that in every case a successful woman is disliked, but this is a social dynamic that is a large barrier for women, and something that you have to figure out how to navigate. And one of the ways is by talking about it and educating people about it, and then figuring ways to overcome it.
So John, picking up on Marianne's point about the stereotypes for women, let me ask you the following questions. For many years, women have emulated men in their leadership styles, believing that the world of business is a man's world. And actually, Marianne's indicated that that might be the perception. Now, that seems to be changing. And what traits are most desirable now in leadership, and why?
So when I started in business, I don't know if any of you are old enough to remember this, but women wore these shoulder pads, you know, in the 80s. Remember the bow tie, and we're going to go play football. And part of that was really conforming, you know, to these, what I believe are out-of-date stereotypes of what leadership is about. And what our book is about with the Athena Doctrine is that there are leadership traits that many people have used, both men and women, to get the top job. But our data shows that those are not the traits you need to keep that job. So running a sustainable company as a leader, you've got to have a blend of masculine and feminine values. And that's what we saw in these people that we met. We interviewed over 64,000 people in 13 countries. And we, in nationally representative samples, we divided the sample in half. Without going into great detail, we modeled it based on taking 125 different human traits to describe what is masculine and feminine. And the other side, which was talking about, with no gendering, what makes an ideal leader. And what we started to see was that the feminine values and traits were in ascendance. Things like selflessness, empathy, collaboration, loyalty, empathy. And what we started to really understand, and it became so interesting to us that we then went out on the road and interviewed people all over the world, were that these were not soft skills. These were actually sources of strength. And they were a reflection of managing what is today a very social, very transparent, and very sort of interdependent economy. So by no means have all of these dynamics resolved themselves. We all know the paltry number of women CEOs and women on boards. But this is an emergent form of leadership, and there's a tremendous amount of really interesting women and men that are starting to learn how to practice this way.
Okay, so Gail, now, you have this great business, and the largest construction company, woman-owned, in the country. Let me ask you, how have you been able to navigate the challenges of being a woman-owned business in a male-dominated industry where we haven't yet changed the leadership traits that we're looking for, and growing from this small business to the largest business that I just described? What competencies have you relied on?
I would tell you that when I was growing up, my mom used to have a saying, or she used to tell people that, you know, Gail, she's the nicest person that you'd ever want to meet. Just don't tick her off. because then you get to see another side. And I think for me, really one of the ways that I was raised in an entrepreneurial household. And growing up, my dad actually had an insurance company, and I worked a lot with him in business. And so I was very fortunate to grow up in an entrepreneurial family and see how business should be ran. And my parents always raised me to be very confident and to be very assertive. And it's kind of hard to have a last name like Warrior and not be a little bit assertive. So for me, going into construction, when I go into a room and I'm typically a lot of times the only female in that room, I don't look at it as that, you know, uh-oh, I've got an issue because I'm the only female in the room. Usually the guys are saying, doggone it, I can't use all those curse words that I really want to use because I got a woman in the room. So I've never really let the fact that I'm a female in a male-dominated industry discourage me from being able to go out and find the projects, hire the right type of people, hire the talent that I need, and be efficient and effective in everything that we need to do.
Shelly, picking up on that, now you've grown BrightStar to be one of the fastest growing companies, we heard that before, in North America, and you talk about your ever-changing culture of adaptability, which is very important in uncertain times. One of the fundamental competencies of being a successful CEO is being adaptable and able to lead in these uncertain times. So how has your mastery of the competency contributed to your success?
I think there's kind of three key ways that I look at this skill set. One, I'm always trying to update our forecasts to let our employees and our franchisees know where we're at and if we've slipped, how we're going to get back on track. So I think it's having confidence that I can get us there, but also demonstrating that confidence so they rally behind and we do what's necessary to be done. So we do a very solid 1-year, 3-year, and 10-year plan. We're always prioritizing our initiatives for the next quarter, kind of taking it bite-sized chunks. So that's the first thing. The second thing is mistakes are going to happen. You're going to get bumps in the road, new government regulation, whatever that might be. And for me, it's about learning from it and then moving on and looking forward, not dwelling. And so that's the second. The third is anytime we've had something where I needed to adapt, it's usually a unexpected large opportunity or it's a setback in the road that we need to overcome. Either of those, both highly good or highly bad, but unexpected, usually involve accessing financing. And so making sure that I have a good command of my numbers. Now, that might be easier for me because I'm a CPA by background. But what I see in female business owners that I mentor is when we get in the room with a banker, we might abdicate the conversation to our CPA. And I think having the command of the numbers, and if you don't have that knowledge, get trained, take an accounting class, whatever that is. But the banker wants to know as the business owner that you're standing behind the numbers, not abdicating to your controller or accountant. And that has been a big area of success for me. I've never once been turned down for financing, but I go in confidently. Even if my CFO's in the room now, I still will lead the conversations with the banker. And I never let the banker have a surprise. If any of us have borrowing-based certificates and we have any kind of lending of any kind, we have financial statements that have to be sent every quarter. If the news are gonna be either higher or lower than what they anticipated, I'm picking up the phone and I'm calling my banker. So when they see it, they're not having to call me, that they know that they're my partner in business and I'm not letting them get asked by their boss what's going on. I've prepared them for that conversation. That gives them the confidence to give me the lending when I need it.
Boy, I hear that word confidence coming up over and over again. It's a really good lesson. So Marianne, picking up on Shelly's comments, let me just ask you, because this is an interesting story, which I didn't know. You have publicly shared the story of how your thesis advisor's disinterest in your thesis shook your confidence, but taught you the valuable lesson to not let others place limits on your abilities nor your belief in yourself. Do you feel this is a common issue for women in business, and how do you think they can combat it? And tell us a little bit about what happened.
Oh, yeah, so under the category of what doesn't kill you makes you stronger. In my department, you have your first big task is to write a master thesis, and your committee is supposed to meet, and you discuss it, and they sign off on it. You have your chair and two other people who read it. So we scheduled the meeting. The two readers showed up. The chair did not. So we rescheduled the meeting, and she did not show up again, which is probably unprecedented. I'm not sure, maybe there was something else going on in her life, but I definitely received a message, which was that my work wasn't important enough for her to attend. So at that moment, I sort of, not that it didn't kind of really rock my confidence, which it did, but ultimately there was a real fork in the road for me, which was like, I guess I could drop out and believe that I'm not capable of doing this, or I can kind of double down on myself and say, I think she's wrong, and I think I am talented, and I think I can do this. And that, by the way, the two other people who read the paper think it's pretty good. So I'm just gonna keep trying. So that's what I did, and it's worked out so far. So in general, self-confidence is a huge issue for women, particularly in business. So women tend to have lower expectations of success in a lot of occupations, and this is emphasized in kind of traditionally male domains like science and math. We see this very early on, like a survey or a study of teenagers found that girls reported lower levels of self-confidence than boys in areas like math, finance, problem solving. And so what happens is that women are more likely to limit their career ambitions because they just don't think they have what it takes. And this plays out in entrepreneurship as well. And I should say that these are self-assessments. These are not actual assessments of ability. So another study of teenagers found that even though it was a study of teenagers and entrepreneurial skills, even though boys and girls actually had comparable skill levels, the girls felt like they weren't prepared enough to really go into entrepreneurship. And you fast forward to women, and studies again find that women feel they don't have entrepreneurial capabilities, and so they have less of an interest of going into entrepreneurship. Now, there's a few ways to address this. One is actually entrepreneurial education, like what's happening today, really increases self-confidence. Because the good news is that self-confidence is not a static thing. We can increase it. So education, role models, and mentors are really important, first for showing you how to do it, and second for believing in you and supporting you. The third thing we can do is to see this for what it is. And so what this is not a measure of actual ability. In my opinion, this is a personal reflection of inequality. So circulating all around us are negative messages about women and girls. We're not good at math, we're not good at leadership, we're not as good as men. So power doesn't work just around you, it actually works through you, and it works through how you feel about yourself. And power raises the expectations of the more powerful, and it lowers the expectations of the less powerful. So when you hear that critical voice in your head, you need to stop, and it's really hard, because it's hard to change the way you feel, but I think you need to adjust to it. And like with my experience with my master's thesis, one way to address inequality is to just double down on yourself. And the reality is that you do have the skills, you're just holding yourself to a higher level and you're being more self-critical. And that's because of the social group you're a part of. So you can address inequality from a public policy perspective, from an organizational policy, all these other things. But one of the fastest ways is to do it in your own head. And understand that this is just a reflection of something else that's bigger than you.
So picking up on that, John, look, you've identified these traits, that feminine traits. What role does confidence play in exhibiting those traits?
Well, I think the people we met around the world, there's this misnomer, we talk about soft skills, it sounds like these people weren't strong. We met incredibly strong women and incredibly strong men that were being more open. And it was a realization that we all have masculine and feminine skills inside of us because we're all human, we're all people. And you know, in one day, I met the president of Israel, Shimon Peres. He was 90 years old, and he said, we're in a new world with many old minds. And the very same day, I met Major General Orna Barbavai, who's the highest ranking woman in any military establishment in any country on the planet. And she talked about military strategy from the perspective of a mother. And I just would say that there were these interesting, innate focus on confidence, because I believe the world is changing. It's not going to happen overnight, but all of you, and for your daughters, and my daughter who's 10, I spoke at Girl Up. All proceeds of our book support Girl Up, because it's an incredible organization. And I just believe that we're at the cusp of a time where there's going to be tremendous optimism and confidence. So all of us should have confidence in this, and I believe the best way to advocate for girls and women is for have men, more middle-aged bald guys like me, understand that these are skills that we can all really apply. And so frame it as competitive advantage. Use data, talk about it, but it's ultimately going to be, a better world in the future.
I think it's great to have you on this panel. I really appreciate your thinking. I really do. Gail. Okay, so you have a passion in actually several different areas, not just in your entrepreneurship, but also in some of the organizations you support. As your business grew and as you grew as a leader, can you share some of the ways that you stuck to your values and ideals without compromising who you are?
Oh gosh, there's probably a number of ways. We only have time for one, huh? One that comes to mind, last year, actually probably end of 2011, there was a contract that we had put a bid in on with a very large general contractor, and we had actually done a lot of work with them previously, and we're very fortunate where we were. It was a time before the market started to decline, and we were hitting double digits on our margins, and so because the industry and the economy as a whole was taking a decline, margins on construction projects were going southward as well. And so we knew that this project was ultimately with the Corps, was the owner. And so we knew that the budget had shrunk. We knew that the available funds overall had shrunk. And so we were the primary subcontractor on this project. And so we knew that we were going to have to skinny our number. And my executive team said, we have to win this project. And I said, okay, we can win the project, but we're not going to win the project just for the sake of winning a project. And so it was an unpopular position that I took. We actually did win the project, but during the course of negotiating, they wanted us to skinny our number even further. And it got to the point where I had to make a decision, do I want to take this project just so I can say I have this project on the books, really not have any contingency in there and possibly lose, you know, a whole lot of money in the end, because even though I have a lot of passion, ultimately what drives a business is profit. And so it is a for-profit and not a non-profit. I do have a non-profit, and that this isn't it. And so we couldn't come to an agreement on ultimately what that number should be between us and the general contractor that we were working with, and they pulled the contract from us. The executive team, there was four of us, there was two people that thought I made the great decision, and two that, including me, that thought we made a good decision, and two that thought it was just the worst thing ever. And that was hard to kind of, you know, go through, because when your executive team doesn't agree, then that kind of, you know, disseminates all the way down through the rest of the organization. And so we have something in the organization that's called the Warrior Creed that we operate by, and it's build trust, be accountable, succeed together are just three of those things. And actually took us about over a year to create that Warrior Creed. And there was no way that we could do that project and we could build trust or succeed together as a team and lose money in the process. In the end, the company that ended up winning that project wished they had never gotten it. And so, you know, hindsight is always 20/20, but I would say, you know, make sure that, you know, stick with your guns, you know, stick with your gut. Being in construction, I'm often, as I said earlier, the only female in the room. And so sometimes people will try to, you know, coerce me to a different path. But after doing this for as many years as I've been doing it, I typically know what works and what doesn't work in regards to the projects that we bid. So it was an unpopular decision, but I stuck to my values and I stuck to what was important for us as an organization, and we moved forward and we ended up finding other projects to replace the one that we had lost.
So our time is really almost up, and I want to ask one last question of Shelly, and that is, you've indicated that asking is very important. Could you just elaborate on that for a brief moment?
Absolutely. I think, you know, Angie said it, you know, the worst thing someone can say is no. And so I've always been a proponent of asking speakers or possible mentors, if I'm going to a conference that know more than I do at a certain stage, for help. I figure all they can do is say no. So I've always had a board of advisors. From the very beginning, I was blessed to have an Athena PowerLink panel board bestowed on me in 2004, and I've maintained that ever since. And I'd be remiss not to ask American Express to include all small business owners, including franchisees of any size brand, in the Small Business Saturday on November 30th. And speaking of asking.
Good way to end. So a very big hand for this excellent, excellent panel. Thank you so much.